prayer. We have Daisy Huff fell and dislocated her knee. They have moved, but this is going to continue to be their home church. She loves this small Christian family. Patty Perio is under the weather, and the Ewell family also starting treatments. And please continue to pray for them for some relief for those girls. Any other prayers we need to be aware of? Praises. They're always good. Okay.
Thank you, Father, for this day and for the opportunity to be together. We pray that during this time, your name would be praised, and that we also pray, Father, that during this time that we would be blessed because of your word and for being together with one another. Again, we thank you. We pray again for your mercy and grace, and most of all, we praise you in your son's name, Jesus. In his name we do pray. Amen.
Testament. It's funny to me, and I, like growing up, you always remember the New Testament first versus the Old Testament. But I want to thank Chris and Denise. This church is truly blessed to have them. The Pioneer Club, just to see it and see these kids every Wednesday being fools and joking and having a good time and learning about God, it's just amazing. For some reason, I'm super nervous. But we've consistently had between 13 and 15 kids every Wednesday. And that's, sometimes you don't even see that on Sunday. So it's pretty awesome. And y'all, I'd like to thank Chris and Denise for heading it up. And,
thank you, everybody that's helped out.
So it's been amazing. Thank you very much. So, whom shall I fear?
Who shall I fear?
next song is a new one. It's called Know You Will. And it's just one of those songs that you hear on the radio, and it speaks to your heart.
Make time for quiet moments, as God whispers and the world is loud. This quote is taken from a plaque in my parents' bathroom, of all places. I've often read this and did not understand what it meant. If God wants us to know He is there, why doesn't He simply shout to us louder than the noise of the world? Why does He choose to whisper? If God spent His time shouting at us, we would not listen. How many of you simply turn off or tune out when you are being yelled at? Or worse yet, become angry yourselves and end up in a shouting match with the other person? If God tried reaching us this way, we would only harden our hearts and turn further from Him, being the headstrong people that we, at least I am anyway. So instead, God waits patiently. He gently whispers the truth we seek, waiting for us to hear to hear him in our own time. Once we realize we need him, we can have a relationship with him through his son, who he sent to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins. As we take communion today, remember to make time for quiet moments as God whispers and the world is loud. Let us pray. Father, I pray that you quiet our minds and our fingers on our electronics, that we would make time to really listen for you and your direction in our lives. Time after time, you have waited before, and now you are waiting again.
We've got something we'd like to share with you this morning. It's a thank you from the Yule family. This is Kaylee in Brooklyn. So you can put a face with the name. They just want to say thank you.
Hi, I'm Kaylee.
Hi,
Pastor. And we just wanted to thank the Tomahawk Church for all their love and support. And we would ask that y'all keep us in your prayers as we go through treatment this summer in Arkansas. Thank you so much. Hi, I'm Kaylee.
Hi, Pastor.
And we just
it's brief, but precious. Thank you all for helping. Greatly appreciate it. It's a privilege to be able to serve here. And I love you guys. I love you all very much. If we are blessed to have family that are believers, it makes life easier. You know? But not everybody has a family of believers. And the way the world has been working, it has been directly working against believers. Pray for those that have to lovingly take a stand to share the gospel with their families. I'd like to ask a special prayer from the church family for Denise this week. She's got a tough week ahead. So be praying for her as she meets her. They meet on Tuesday. But let's pray. Dear God, thank you for who you are. God, thank you for the privilege of being able to be a part of your family and being able to serve you. Lord, thank you for the precious faith. And Lord, if we were in tune with your spirit this morning, we are in awe and greatly thankful that the faith is beginning to be passed on to the younger generations. We thank you and we praise you for that. To me, there's nothing more precious than that. And so, Lord, we just pray that everyone will come to know you, the Savior, the Lord, and walk with you, and that you'll strengthen this church family. I pray especially for Denise this week. God, I pray that you please give her the right words to be able to share with her family and speak the truth and love. And thank you for all you do for us in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have to turn to Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4. I want to thank Mr. Mike for filling in to preach last week. Thank you very much, Mr. Mike. Also for Robin to help for helping take care of the gardens. Thank you, Robin. And thank you also to the whole church family for the time off. It was wonderful. We were able to get some rest and spend time together as a family, and then go and see my grandmother, and just to see Ellie run in and give my grandma a big hug and pay the whole trip worth it. It really is precious, precious to be. We're going to be continuing our study in the book of Nehemiah. Today we're going to be talking about workers and warriors. Workers and warriors from Nehemiah chapter 4. Gilbert Chesterton once wrote, "The Bible tells us to love our neighbors and also to love our enemies. Probably because, generally speaking, they're the same people." That's a quote by Gilbert Chesterton. Okay? These words were certainly true in Nehemiah's situation. His arrival in Jerusalem was a threat, and I've always heard of his name being Sanballat. When I read it, it doesn't say Sanballat to me. I see Sanballat. That's how I pronounce it from here on out. Okay? Was a threat to Sanballat and his associates, who wanted to keep the Jews weak and dependent. A strong Jerusalem would endanger the balance of power in the region, and it would rob Sanballat and his friends of influence and wealth. This has been my personal experience, and I've been told this many, many times by people as well. When things are going well, get ready. Trouble's coming. Because the enemy doesn't want the work of the Lord to make progress. Read that again. When things are going well, get ready for trouble, because the enemy doesn't want the work of the Lord to make progress. As long as the people in Jerusalem, as long as they were content with their sad lot, the enemy left them alone. But when the Jews began to serve the Lord and to bring glory to God's name, the enemy became active. My own personal experience has been the most spiritually intense, the most difficult, the most challenging ministries, in the long run, most of the time, have been the ones that bore the most fruit. And also, they had the potential to bear the most fruit, a great deal of fruit. Warren Wiersbe writes this, Opposition is not only an evidence that God is blessing, but it is also an opportunity for us to grow. The difficulties that came to the work brought out the best in Nehemiah and in his people. Satan wanted to use these problems and as weapons to destroy the work. But God used them as tools to build his people. Charles Spurgeon once said, God had one son without sin. But he never had one son without trial. Read again. God had one son without sin. But he never had a son without pride. They say in ministry, your first year is just getting to know the people and the people getting to know you. And Lord willing, we're about to complete our first year of ministry here. It has been a very good year overall. And by the way, I want to thank those again. Anybody that's serving in any capacity, thank you all very much. We greatly appreciate you all, especially helping with the little ones. We greatly appreciate it. However, be in prayer continually, because with God's help, we are now beginning to spiritually build the walls that have been torn down through difficulty, mostly from external circumstances. We are not the only church going through this, but we are one of them. Prepare for difficulty, because the enemy will try anything to destroy the work of God. Remember, however, God is greater, and in the end, God wins. We just need to walk with God and be his people. When Sir James Thornhill was painting the inside of the cupola of St. Paul's Cathedral in London, at one point he finished an area of work and he stopped and took a step back. When he stopped to take a step back, he was up on scaffolding. And had he taken one more step, he would have fallen to his death. Seeing the situation, a friend of his grabbed a brush and rubbed paint on part of the painting. The artist, not wanting his painting to be destroyed, rushed forward to protect his work. And at the same time, it saved his life. When the picture of our life and our ministry is not all that we think that it ought to be, perhaps the master artist is rescuing us from something far worse or preparing us for something far better. Chapters 4 through 6 shows the spiritual war is beginning to intensify greatly. It's beginning to intensify greatly. These chapters show 9 different tactics that the enemy used to try to destroy the work. First, they attack the Jewish people through ridicule. Found in verses 1 through 6 of the chapter. Then they tried plots of war. This resulted in difficulties within the Jewish ranks. Discouragement was another. Then fear, verses 11 to 23. Then selfishness in chapter 5. When the attacks of the people failed to stop the work, the enemy then began to attack the leader, Nehemiah. They tried compromise. They tried slander. They tried threats. They tried intrigue. But none of these devices would work either. Nehemiah was steadfast and unmovable and led his people to finish the work, and this is amazing, in just 52 days. That's incredible. Okay? Referring to Satan, Paul wrote this, "For we are not ignorant of his devices." That's 2 Corinthians 2:11. We're not ignorant of his devices. He will try most anything to destroy the work of God. We need to pray and ask God for spiritual discernment and stay in the Word so that we recognize what the enemy's up to and fight back against it. This chapter presents four of Satan's devices for opposing the Lord's work, and also tells us how God's people can be steadfast and defeat the enemy. If you start building, you will soon be battled. It's part of being a Christian and doing the Lord's work. The first tactic that the enemy used was ridicule. Thomas Carlyle once said, "Ridicule is the language of the devil. Some people can stand bravely when they're being shot at, but they will collapse if they're laughing." Think about that. Some people can stand bravely when they're shot at, but they'll collapse when they're laughing. Shakespeare called ridicule paper bullets of the brain. But those bullets have slain many a warrior. I personally can think of many who started out in ministry, and either their first ministry or the beginning of their second ministry, because of going through constant ridicule, they left the ministry. It's not unusual for the enemy to insult the servants of God. That's part of the territory. Okay? It's not unusual for the enemy to insult the servants of God. Goliath, what did he do? He ridiculed David when the shepherd boy met the giant with only a sling in his hand. Jesus was mocked by soldiers during the trial and by many in the crowd as he hung upon the cross. And many, if not most, of the heroes of the faith had to endure mocking. In the long list of things that endured, it mentions this in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 36. Some faced jeers, some faced flogging, while others were chained and put into prison. I personally can only think of a very few. I mean, think, rack your brain on this for a minute. How many can you really truly think of in Scripture that didn't face mocking and ridicule? I mean, it's a very short list, and even that it's not mentioned, you know? I mean, most every single Bible hero that you can think of, most every single one of them, faced mocking and ridicule. When the enemy laughs at God's people and what they're doing, it's usually a sign that God is going to bless those people in a wonderful way. When the enemy rages on earth, God laughs in heaven. Sanballat and his friends had begun to ridicule the Jews even before the work on the wall had begun. And Nehemiah wrote this, They laughed us to scorn us. They despised us, Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 19 says. What relationship that Sanballat had with the army of Samaria is not explained to us, but he likely had the army assembled as a show of strength to frighten the Jews. By making his first speech in front of the army, Sanballat intensified the power of his ridicule, and he made some important people laugh at the Jews. First, Sanballat ridiculed the workers in verse 1 by calling them feeble Jews. The word feeble, you know what it means? It means withered or miserable. The people were like cut flowers fading away. You know, we went on vacation. Denise wanted to stop by a place for some flowers, and we picked a few. Most of them, it was past peak season for one. So most of them were looking great, but there were a few that were nice. Okay, and we went and cut some flowers, right? Well, guess what? About 2 days, what happened? Flowers don't last very long, do they? They wither pretty quickly, don't they? Okay, so the
resources that the people could see. But the enemy could not see their greatest spiritual resources. People of the world don't understand that God delights in using feeble instruments to accomplish his work. 1 Corinthians 1:27 says this, "But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. The world glories in wealth and in power, but God's people glory in poverty and weakness. When we are weak, then we are strong." 2 Corinthians 12:10. Then Sanballat ridiculed the work itself. He's asking three questions. He's asking three, not just three questions, but three taunting questions. Referring to the walls. Will they fortify themselves? Must have evoked lots of laughter from the Samaritan army. How could the feeble Jews hope to build a wall strong enough to protect the city from an army? Will they sacrifice? Implies it will take more than just prayer and worship to rebuild the city. This question was blasphemy against God. Sanballat was denying that God would help his people. Will they finish in one day? Or will they finish in a day? It suggests that the Jews didn't know how difficult it would be and that they soon would quit the work. In his final question, Sanballat ridiculed the materials that were being used. The stones were old and they were damaged. However, there were still many good stones that could still be used to build upon. Scripture talks about we are living stones, and that God is forming us into a spiritual building. Think about it, not a physical building, but a spiritual building. That God is using us to build right now as we speak, something that will be pleasing to him. In his final question, Sanballat went into the materials that were being used. The stones were old and damaged. Okay, read it for me. Tobiah the Ammonite was one of the inspectors. When it was his turn to speak, he ridiculed the finished product. "You wouldn't need an army. Only a solitary fox could tear these walls down." From their perspective, actually, a lot of that part was true. That they had great faith in our great God. And that's what made the difference. How did Nehemiah respond to the ridicule? He prayed and he asked God to fight the enemy for him. "Hear us, O God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their heads." Nehemiah 4:4 says. This is the third time that it mentions that Nehemiah prays. It's the third time that Nehemiah prays, and it won't be the last time he mentions that Nehemiah prays. Nehemiah did not allow himself to get detoured from the work by taking time to reply to their words. The Lord had heard the sneering taunts of Sanballat and Tobiah, and he would deal with them in his own time, in his own way. The opposition of Sanballat and Tobiah against the Jews was not a resistance so much against the Jews, but against who? Against God himself. That's really who their opposition was against. Okay? It was against God himself. Also want to show that their ridicule did not work. In verse 6 it says this, "So we rebuilt the wall till it reached half its height. For the people," it says this, "they worked with all of their heart." The people worked with all of their heart. Are we today serving God in his church with all of our heart? If not, it's time to. The second tactic the enemy used were intimidating plots. Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 8 says this, "They all plotted together to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to stir up trouble against it." Now, what's the difference between a plan and a plot? A plan is something you take, they pray about, they think through, and a plan, in almost every case, is something that is good and beneficial for the people, right? It's going to help them. What's a plot? A plot is when people meet in secret, and their plan remains a secret, and it's never meant to do good to those that are going, what they're going through. It's meant to do harm.
Okay? So they plotted. They came with an intimidating plot. A common enemy and a common cause brought four different groups together to stop the work on the walls of Jerusalem. The city was now completely surrounded by enemies. To the north was Sanballat and the Samaritans. To the east was Tobiah and the Ammonites, by the way. I said that wrong a couple weeks ago. I said Amorites. It's not Amorites. It's Ammonites. Okay, so, all right. So Tobiah and the Ammonites. And to the south was Geshem and the Arabs. And to the west were the Ashdodites or the Philistines. Okay? God's people sometimes have difficulty working together, but the people of the world have no problem uniting against the work of the Lord. Have you ever noticed that? All right? I mean, that happens. Tons of scripture on this. As the enemy saw the work progressing, they became angry, and they decided to plan a secret attack against Jerusalem. Satan hates the Jews, and he hates Christians as well. God chose for the Jews to be the vehicle for giving the knowledge of the one true God, for the scriptures themselves, and ultimately for our Lord Jesus Christ. Satan wanted to prevent the Savior of the world from coming into the world. Remember, it was prophesied to him all the way back where? Where did Satan first hear that there's a prophecy against him? Where was it? In Genesis, in the Garden of Eden, right? Okay? You will strike his heel, but he will crush your head, right? Okay. Nehemiah suspected that his enemies would launch an attack, so he posted a guard and he encouraged the people to pray. I want to encourage all of you to pray for our congregation, because it's a good thing. It honors the Lord. It helps your walk with God. It helps everybody else's walk with God. But it also helps the spiritually protect us as a church family. So please spend time in God's Word, but also spend time in prayer with the Lord. The workers held both tools and weapons at the same time. And we don't think in terms like that, but workers held both tools and weapons. Those who carried materials did their work with one hand, and they held weapons with the other. That's chapter 4, verse 17. And they prepared to fight when the signal was given. Jesus said for us to watch and pray. And it combines both faith and works. And it's a great example for us to follow in our work and also in spiritual warfare as well. The Christian's battle is not against flesh and blood, but against Satan and his demonic forces that use flesh and blood to oppose the Lord's work. If we hope to win the war and finish the work, we must first equip ourselves with what the Word of God says, with the spiritual equipment that God has provided for us. You can find that in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18, but that's another sermon. But that's the armor of God, putting on the armor of God. If we focus on the visible enemy alone, and we forget the invisible enemy, we will fail. We must watch, we must pray, we must put on the spiritual armor, and we must remember the invisible enemy. Now, the third tactic that the enemy used was discouragement. Pressures from without often cause problems within. It isn't easy to carry on your work when you are surrounded by danger and daily face the demands of the task that seems impossible. If the Jews became discouraged, they would defeat themselves. Have y'all ever been there? I have. I think most people have. You have this big task ahead of you, and something happens. Trial, whatever it was, and you became discouraged, right? You've all been there. I'm thinking at some point you have. But what does that do? That doesn't help you, and it doesn't help the work. So what do you have to do? You spend time with God. You spend time in prayer. You spend time in His Word. You recharge your batteries. And you have other brothers and sisters in Christ that will speak truth into your life. And then you've got to look up. You got to keep going. You got to keep moving. You can't allow discouragement to paralyze you. You have to keep going, even if it's just one little step at a time. If the Jews became discouraged, they would defeat themselves. Sanballat and his allies would never have to wage a war. Discouragement is a key weapon in Satan's arsenal. It was a lack of faith and discouragement, if you remember, that kept Israel from entering the promised land to begin with. Right? Remember that? They said, "We will not be able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we," in Numbers chapter 13, verse 31. If you remember, 12 men went to spy on Canaan, 10 were bad, and 2 were good. What did they see when they spied on Canaan?
10 were bad, 2 were good, some saw giants big and tall, some saw God is overall, right? You guys remember, hopefully you guys remember that song, okay? I don't remember all the words, but 10 were bad, 2 were good, right? Okay, so what happened there, right? Moses sent them in. He's like, check out the land. Come back and give us a report. Let us know what's happening, right? Caleb and Joshua went in. Well, we're going to do it in a minute. But 10 of them came back, and they, when they asked for the report, 10 of them were like, oh, we can't do it. They're too big. They'll kill us. We've got no hope. Joshua and Caleb were like, guys, listen. Believe in God. Do what God wants you to do, and we'll inherit the promised land. And what happened? Well, sadly, the people followed the negative. The people followed the discouraging group. And what happened was, is they all, that whole crew died out in the desert because of their lack of faith and because they allowed their hearts to be discouraged. Had they had faith, had they believed Joshua and Caleb, it would have been just the 10 spies left out and everybody else would have been blessed and they would have been promised land. Guys, we have to live by faith. We have to do what God wants us to do. We can't allow discouragement. God will tell you, I can't act like it never happens to me. Right? Right? We can't allow discouragement to get us down. We have to stay focused on the Lord. As a result, the nation wandered in the wilderness for 40 years until a new generation was ready to conquer the land. "We're not able" is the rallying cry for all those who take their eyes off of the Lord and start looking at themselves and their problems. Remember Peter? As long as he kept his eyes on Jesus, in fact, Audio Adrenaline has a song about this, "If I keep my eyes on Jesus, I can walk on water," right? When he kept his eyes on Jesus, he could walk on water. He could do something that was physically impossible, but with God's help, it was possible, right? Because all things are possible with God, right? But when he took his eyes off of Jesus, what happened? He began to sink. And the same is true for us spiritually. We have to keep our eyes on Jesus so that we spiritually won't sin. This discouraged Jews actually agreeing with the enemy who said they were feeble. Sanballat had openly declared that the work would stop, and it almost did. Remember, it worked the first time around, but it wouldn't work here. Why did discouragement arise from the royal tribe of Judah? This was David's bloodline. David was one of the greatest warriors to ever live. They should have been men and women of great courage. The answer is found in Nehemiah chapter 6, verses 17 through 19. Some of the people were secretly cooperating with the enemy. That was the problem. Some of the people were secretly cooperating with the enemy. The ties of marriage were stronger than bonds of commitment to the Lord, at least for them. In chapter 13, verses 15 through 22, some of the leaders were not wholly devoted to the Lord, but were more interested in making money. The combination of marriage and money divided their loyalties, and they became the cause of the discouragement. Wearsby writes this: in over 40 years of him speaking of his ministry, in over 40 years of ministry, I've learned that in the Lord's work, discouragers are often doubters and compromisers. There is usually something wrong in their spiritual walk. They frequently lack faith in God's word, for one thing, and they are primarily interested in only their own plans and their own pursuits. A double-minded person is an unbelieving and unstable, according to James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8, and it hinders the work of the Lord. Nehemiah didn't pay attention to the complainers, but he went right on with the work of the Lord that God had given him. If you take away from the work and listen to everyone who wants attention, you'll never get anything done. Nehemiah got his encouragement from time with God in prayer and remembered, my sweet mama, whenever I'm going through a tough time, I know I can call her, and she points me back. She points me back to the Word of God every time. And I love that about her. But I can remember, like, college, trials, or no matter what it was, she would say, she'll say this: Chris, remember the promises of God. Remember the promises of God. And I want to encourage you guys with that. You may be going through some terrible stuff, but remember the promises of God. Be faithful and God will see you
through. The fourth tactic that the enemy used was fear. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 12 says, "Then the Jews who lived near them came and told them 10 times over. So they're making a point, okay? Wherever you turn, you're going to be attacked. Wherever you turn, you're going to be attacked. And that's all over here. Wherever you turn, you're going to be attacked, right? The Jews that lived in the outlying village kept bringing in a report to the city that the enemy was planning another surprise attack. Whether the Jews were merely spreading rumors, we don't know. I think they were working with the other group and they were trying to just stir everybody up. Nehemiah didn't respond immediately. He probably was spending time in God's presence asking for God's guidance. He himself was not afraid of the enemy, but when he saw that the people were starting to become afraid, that's when he decided to act. Fear paralyzes people, and sometimes it's contagious. You guys remember Gideon? And they were selecting those and who were going to battle. And the ones that went to, the ones that did not keep their heads up and look, they were sent home. Right? But the ones who brought the water up to their mouth, those were the ones that they kept. And they ended up being very courageous. They only had like 300, I'm going from memory on that, but I think it was like 300 that went up against thousands. And God gave them the victory. Fear paralyzes people, and sometimes it's contagious. In fact, early on in the Old Testament, it mentions, if you're afraid, go home. What? That's what it says. If you're afraid, go home. You trust in the Lord. You be faithful. Be strong and courageous. Other fear and faith, have a healthy fear of God, but after that, fear and faith cannot exist. A healthy fear of God is actually where we get our strength from. It's actually where we get our courage, where we get our boldness. Fear of anything else brings defeat. Nehemiah's first step was to post guards at the most vulnerable places on the wall. The enemy could then see that the Jews were prepared to fight. He armed entire families, knowing that they would stand together and that they would encourage one another. The Jews not only repaired the walls near their own houses, but they stood with their families to protect their homes and protect their city. After looking the situation over, Nehemiah then encouraged the people to not be afraid and to look to the Lord for help. Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 14, second part. This is Nehemiah. Don't be afraid of them. Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome. If we fear the Lord, we don't need to fear the enemy. Nehemiah's heart was captivated by the great and awesome God of Israel. He knew that God was and is strong enough to meet any challenge. He also reminded the people that they were fighting for their nation, they were fighting for their city, they were fighting for their families. If the nation was destroyed, what would become of God's great promises for Israel and his plan for redemption? When we face a situation that may create fear, we must remind ourselves of the greatness of God that we serve. If we keep our focus on God, we can make it through anything. Still trust and prepare, yes, that's true. But we can make it through anything because God is our strength. When the enemy learned that Jerusalem was armed and ready, they backed off. God had frustrated their plot. Verse 15, it says, when our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we all return to the wall, each to his own work. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. Psalms 33 says, Nehemiah knew that he couldn't interrupt the work every time that he heard a rumor. So he set a defense on the wall to solve the problem. Many of the men who worked on the wall, the other half stood guard. He saw to it that the people who carried materials also carried weapons, and that the workers on the wall carried swords. In this way, the work would not be interrupted, and the workers would be ready in case the alarm went off if they were ready to fight. The man with the trumpet always stayed close to Nehemiah so that the alarm could be given immediately if it needed to be. The people were prepared to fight, but they realized it was God who fought for them, and he alone could give the victory. Charles Spurgeon named his magazine this, and he borrowed this from Nehemiah. He named it, The Sword and the Trap. He said it was to record the it was to record a combat with sin and labor for the Lord. Brothers and sisters, it's not enough just to build the wall. It's not enough just to build the wall. We must also be on guard, or the enemy will take it from us. Building and battle are both a normal part of the Christian life if we're faithful disciples. Nehemiah again encouraged the people. He reminded them that they were involved in a great work. Then he said in Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 20, "Whenever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us." After all, they were serving the great, true God and rebuilding the walls of the city. He also reminded them not to work alone, but to work with other workers. To work with other workers. God was with them, and he would come to their defense. And if we will spend time with God, and we will walk faithfully with him and do what God wants us to do, he will come to our defense today as well. No matter where they are, they kept an ear for the sound. No matter where they were, they kept an ear for the sound of the trumpet. And we must be listening for the Lord's trumpet to blow. And 1 Thessalonians tells us, chapter 4, verse 16, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet of God." Do you look forward to that day when that trumpet sounds?
Amen.
I do. I hope you do. Nehemiah also had a second shift that watched through the night to help protect them. He not only organized the guard, but he encouraged them to trust in the Lord. He also set the right example before them, and he was a leader who served and a servant who led. He, along with others, were alert all the time. Dr. Alan Redpath explained why the Jews succeeded in getting their work done and in keeping the enemy at bay. He said, "The people," and I hope and pray this is true of us as well, "the people had a mind to work, a heart to pray, an eye to watch, and an ear to hear. And God blessed them with the victory. They also had a godly leader who had faith to stand." 1 Corinthians 15:58 tells us, "Therefore be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord." This morning, if you have a decision to make for Jesus Christ, please come forward as we sing our invitation song.
Thank you. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity you've given us to be here today, sing praise over your name, to have communion with you, and to hear your word proclaimed by Chris. Father, may we take these words and apply them to our lives. May we strive to be stronger servants of your kingdom. Father, we give you thanks for all the blessings you share upon us. We also ask, Father, to be with those who have been mentioned on our prayer list, whatever their needs may be. Be thy will, may you address those needs. We ask now that you be with us as we depart from this place. Give us safety in our travels and allow us to come back next appointed hour. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
God loves you. We love you. Have a great week. God bless y'all.